296 miles of mainline railway, annually hauling more than 3 million tons of freight and 125,000 passengers through an area of virtually unspoiled wilderness. That's the Algoma Central Railway. Since its incorporation in 1899, the railway has become not only a prime mover of iron ore and forest products, but a major passenger carrier. The famous Agua Canyon Tour began operating in 1952, followed in 1967 by the Tour of the Line. 1972 saw the snow train started, and it's aboard this train that we'll start our look at the ACR. Operating weekends from January to mid-March, the snow train heads 120 miles straight north from the Sioux to Eaton, a siding just north of the famous Agua Canyon. At Eaton, the tour consist is handed over to southbound local number 2 for the return trip. Let's see for ourselves this snow-clad wilderness as we join the head-end crew of train number 1, the snow train. As you have noticed, a night of fresh snow combined with a brisk wind off Lake Superior has left the right-of-way well covered. But with the 6,000 horsepower of our three GP38-2s, even the well-formed drifts near Ogedaki are no match to our northbound consist. Snow fighting is a costly and time-consuming operation for any railway, and when conditions warrant, special equipment is called into play. Two wedge plows, along with spreaders, a flanger, and self-propelled switch brooms equipped with snow blowers make up the ACR snow fighting roster. Their use is the decision of the roadmaster or track inspector. Today's snow is nothing out of the ordinary in Algoma country, so the heaviest equipment needed is the faithful shovel. Just past Trout Lake at Mecatina, we'll see the track inspector's high rail truck. He's been out since before dawn, cleaning switches and inspecting track. North of Sault Ste. Marie is Regent. Nothing more than a passing track, it is here we meet number 12, a southbound Hawk Junction to Steelton freight. Departs Regent while we continue on to Montreal Falls and the spectacular Montreal River Bridge. Spanning the Montreal River, the bridge itself is 1,550 feet in length and 130 feet high. Track speed across the structure is 20 miles per hour, thus passengers have ample time to view this Algoma Central landmark. Thank you. Once clear of the bridge, we waste no time in accelerating for the climb to mile 97, the railway's highest point, 1,589 feet. Freighter is the location of our second meet, so once again we take the siding. This time it's extra 182 south, a train of pulpwood and iron ore, destined to Sault Ste. Marie. As with the meet at Regent, once we clear, the southbound extra wastes no time in departing. Meanwhile, 23 miles to the south, number 12, the train we met at Regent, has just cut off to lift 8 cars of logs destined to Sault Ste. Marie. Having completed its lift, 12 starts the slow 7-mile climb to summit, while to the north, our train passes Freighter Station and starts the 12-mile, 500-foot descent to the floor of Agua Canyon. Immediately after the brief stop, we penetrate the canyon. Here, the gorge narrows to as little as 50 feet before suddenly widening to a well-treed valley. And yellow mile board sign both announce we are 1 mile to the south of the snow train's northern destination of Eaton. This is where number one hands over the 13-car snow train consist to southbound number two. And if you look closely, you'll see the crew already has the markers up on the second coach in readiness for its continuing trip north to Hearst. Also, as three GP38s are obviously too much power for a 4-car train, the two trailing units will be set off at Hawk Junction and will rejoin number two the next day. Now aboard number two, we pull ahead to couple onto the snow train coaches, then shortly afterwards begin our 120-mile trip south to Sault Ste. Marie. As our train passes through the Canyon Park area, it soon becomes clear why snow train passengers don't get the two-hour stop afforded the summer and fall tour groups. Could you imagine the 667 passengers we have aboard today wandering through the 3 feet of snow using snowshoes? It would be most interesting, to say the least. Now climbing out of the canyon, try to keep these scenes in mind. We'll revisit the area in the spectacular fall season, and what a contrast the seasons are. Shortly after we pass a group of snowmobilers proudly flying the Canadian flag, we make a brief stop at the tiny Trout Lake station. Once he's aboard, we continue south through plenty of drifts to Search Mount, where we'll pick up orders and detrain a number of local passengers. Arrival time at Sault Ste. Marie is 4:30 p.m., so already the sun is casting long winter shadows. With the trip complete, passengers detrain, while ahead at the baggage cars, the job of unloading skidoos is well underway. Let's now leave the frozen beauty of winter and jump a few months ahead to summer, the season when Algoma country becomes a paradise for campers, sportsmen, and in general, anyone who enjoys the great outdoors. Although our coverage will concentrate on the northern subdivision, the 131 miles between Hawk Junction and Hearst, we will start out with a brief look at the morning activity on both the Sioux and Michipicoten subs. During the summer months, regular ACR freights on the Sioux subdivision mostly run at night, so the day's first northbound is number 3, the tour train. Because of its proximity to large areas of water, patchy morning fog is common in ACR country. As per usual, 3 penetrates the morning mist near Hayden, breaks into the clear crossing the 810-foot-long, 100-foot-high Bellevue Trestle, then gets back into fog through the Search Mount area. And 38 minutes after 3 passes Search Mount, number 1, the local to Hearst, is scheduled to arrive. Prior to this, and under now clear skies, Search Mount Station becomes a hive of activity, in much the same way that stations all across North America used to, before the automobile doomed their future. With no road access, the local is the way north. Freight waybills are made out, tickets sold, then the train orders are copied, repeated, and readied for delivery to number one's crew.
Engine 205 to run JC5E with mileage 66 SX to ISX 66 until 1520 FF vent event Y1529 JVK.
Station work now complete. Number one is soon on its way north again. And 30 minutes and numerous flag stops later, number one pulls into Freighter, a tiny community to the south of Canyon, and one of the few along the ACR with road access. Here, as at Searchmount, a large number of passengers board for various points north. We now skip north to Hawk Junction, where number two, the local from Hearst, pauses before we see it again, continuing south to Sault Ste. Marie. Before we make our way north to Hearst, let's briefly look at the activity on the Michipicoten sub, a 26-mile branch running between Hawk Junction and Michipicoten Harbor. Iron ore is the mainstay of this line, and here we see extra 184 West departing Hawk Junction with a string of ore empties behind the three railway service cars. Just before starting the switching duties at Wawa, the train passes the Algoma Steel Company's sinter plant. This is where locally mined iron ore is blended with limestone and other additives before being shipped by rail to Algoma Steel in Sault Ste. Marie. Most traffic on the branch is directly related to the steel industry, so it can vary significantly. But as an example, over 1 million tons of ore was moved during 1988. Ore cars are considerably shorter than regular freight equipment, but don't let that fool you. When loaded, These cars weigh in at 125 tons each. Extra 184 West now heads to Michipicoten Harbor, where it will exchange these empties for cars of limestone loaded from bulk carrier ships. Algoma Central's steepest grade, just under 4%, is 2 miles west of Wawa. Thus, with heavy trains on that kind of grade, it's easy to see why the railway's 3,000 horsepower SD40s get this assignment. Heading north out of Hawk Junction, it's now time to take in Algoma Central's northern subdivision. Aboard train number 5, a Hawk Junction to Hearst freight, we'll see how operationally and geographically different the north end of the railway is compared to the better known Sioux subdivision. Our first stop on the way north is Friends, where the ACR crosses CP Rail's transcontinental main line. Once a southbound extra departs, our power cuts off and picks up the tail end crew before lifting some interchange cars from a recently arrived CP freight. Inside the station, our crew picks up waybills and train orders, then awaits the arrival of number 1, the train we are to follow to Hearst. Number 1 gone, 5 wastes no time in taking advantage of the clear signal to cross the CP Rail main line. The signals at this interlocking are controlled by the CP dispatcher at Schreiber, and when their traffic is heavy, ACR trains often get hefty waits. The landscape north of Hawk Junction is predominantly wilderness and moose country. It is largely unpopulated, dotted with multitudes of small lakes, stands of jack pines and spruce, and is saturated with marshes, known by the Indians as muskeg. Muskeg is well known to the ACR, and across the Muskeg Bottom Squaw Bay and Hoodoo Bay sections of Oba Lake, 3 floating bridges were built. Our train is crossing one of them now, but during tomorrow's trip, we'll see all 3. At Oba, we cross Canadian National's transcontinental mainline. Like France, Oba is a very small community, and vehicle access to the outside world is limited to a year-round bush road. About halfway between Oba and Hearst, the countryside slowly changes from stands of jack pine and spruce to that of farming. With the time being almost 9 p.m., the last rays of the sun have disappeared long before we yard the train at Hearst, Algoma Central's northernmost terminal. The next morning finds number two just about ready to depart the Moose Capital of Canada. Well, in the yard, number six is already assembling its southbound consist. At Hearst, the ACR shares the CN station and yard, which were originally part of the old National Transcontinental Railway. As we depart Hearst on number two, we travel on the CN for the first 1.5 miles to the Y. CN has recently abandoned the Hearst to Nakina line, with the exception of 22 miles west of the Hearst Y. This has been kept as a spur to serve the forest industry. Only one stop is made before Oba, this time to pick up a group of fishermen and their equipment. Canoes are the main item at this stop, but depending on the season, ACR baggage cars may contain moose carcasses, bear skins, fish, outboard motors, and of course, beer. We'll leave number two at Oba, then await the arrival of southbound freight number six, which will ride through to Hawk Junction. Six is not far behind today, but it will be in Oba for some time as there is a fair amount of interchange traffic. Normally, both east and west traffic is interchanged with the CN, while the CP interchange at Friends is mainly for west traffic only. CP serves the Sioux directly from Sudbury and naturally wants to keep traffic on its own lines when possible. Once the switch list is obtained, six completes its work, then proceeds to the station to obtain new train orders.
You take that service again, you lift that over through the Hawk Junction. Five's a go, six is beating an extra.
Once ready, our train pulls ahead to the interlocking signal, waits for an eastbound CN extra to pass, then once again continues south towards Hawk Junction. Thank you. 30 miles south of Oba, between mileage 214.2 and 211.9, we again cross the ACR's three floating bridges. Since Muskeg is virtually bottomless, engineers drove wooden piles of BC fir some 60 feet into the Muskeg. Acting as a base of gooey mud to the multitude of pilings, the Muskeg causes the bridges to actually float. While successful, the 20-mile-an-hour track speed combined with difficult and costly maintenance is causing the ACR to seriously look at a new track diversion around the east side of Oba Lake. South of Hilda, we skirt the shores of Wabatangushi and Peckerwood Lake. Just to the north, at mile 210, we cross the Arctic watershed. All water to the north of that point flows to James Bay, while to the south, it flows to Lake Superior. At Friends, new train orders are delivered as we pull our consist in the clear, so number one may continue north to Hearst. Our train has a number of cars for CP today, so once the local has departed, they are cut off and back to the interchange track. Then our units return, couple on, and we're once again southbound to Hawk. Like many smaller railroads, Algoma Central takes pride in its motive power. Its 26 units are generally clean and very well maintained. In 1952, the ACR became the first Canadian railway to become completely dieselized. The two GP7s we have today, although built in 1952, are far from original. In 1978, 170, along with three of her sisters, were completely upgraded by CN. While 101 and four other Jeeps received the same treatment from GM Diesel. Arrival at Hawk Junction marks the end of our trip on the Northern Subdivision, as well as the end of another run for our friendly ACR crew. At Hawk, the power cuts off, runs to the tail end of the train to get the caboose. Then, after switching the caboose to the van alley, heads to the diesel shop for servicing and the next assignment. Parting waves, so typical of Algoma Central people, we'll leave Hawk Junction and head for Montreal Falls, just in time to see number four, the southbound tour train. Always a highlight for tour train passengers, The curving 1,550-foot trestle is 130 feet high and is anchored in a power dam, which retains the waters of the Montreal River. Two other dams are further downstream, but are not visible from the bridge. Power generated here supplies the city of Sault Ste. Marie and surrounding area. Over 700 passengers are enjoying the views afforded by Number 4 today, and recent figures show over 100,000 people yearly taking the canyon tours. This is indeed impressive growth from the 30,000 carried annually by the end of the 60s. PM is arrival time at the Sioux, and Number 4 is two GP38s spliced by a GP7 slowly pull the 17-car train into the Sioux station and the southbound end of Algoma Central's main line. While passengers detrain, just south of Hayden, a work train heads for Steelton. Our final look at summer finds Number 2 wasting no time on its last 13 miles of the 296-mile run from Hearst. Fall in Algoma Central Country is something very special. With the normally spectacular scenery now ablaze with color, this is the season when the railway's tour trains run to capacity. And for our fall coverage, these trains will be the focus of our attention. As per the summer operation, the tour trains run 114 miles north from Sault Ste. Marie to Canyon, where passengers are afforded a relaxing 2-hour stopover at Agua Canyon Park. Just past 8 a.m., Number 3 of the northbound tour train passes the Algoma Steel Plant, while in the background, the International Bridge looms out of the morning mist. While cool overnight temperatures and an abundance of surrounding water make morning fog a common occurrence in Algoma country, it's usually not long after departure that the sun has started burning through. Trains 3 and 4 are strictly tour trains. They do no local work, and unless operationally necessary, run non-stop to Canyon and back. This type of operation is required to successfully cover the 228-mile return trip and still afford passengers 2 hours to enjoy the sights of the Agua Canyon. Montreal River Bridge is certainly a different sight now compared to when we crossed it in winter. With the ice replaced by glistening blue water and the trees making a superb background, the 4 units and 24 cars of our train make a most impressive sight from 2 miles upriver. With colorful passenger trains and scenery like this, it's little wonder that the Algoma Central is a favorite of photographers around the world. Now that looks like a great way to see the railway. Let's leave number 3 for now and join communications gang foreman Eldon Harris on his trip from Montreal Falls to Hubert aboard the gang's speeder. Hubert is the location of the communications work train, and Eldon's crew is erecting a radio tower on top of a nearby hill. As we head to Hubert, rest assured we will not be surprised by an oncoming train. Though much smaller, railway speeders, high rail trucks, and track units are all governed by rules similar to those followed by train crews. Safety is of the first importance, so train movements are carefully checked and confirmed with the dispatcher before setting out. With your safety now assured, just relax and enjoy this track-level view of the ACR between Montreal Falls and Hubert. After delivering some drill bits to the tool car, it's on to the crew diner in search of a late lunch and some freshly made banana split cheesecake.
Here you go, Noof.
Oh, there is one for supper.
Later on.
While we enjoy lunch, an extra freight arrives with a string of pulpwood cars, cuts off the power, and runs back to pick up the van. While this is occurring at Hubert, A look 18 miles to the north finds number 3 arriving at Canyon, the highlight of the tour train itinerary. The Agua Canyon Park certainly looks a lot different now compared to when we passed through aboard the snow train. After detraining, passengers have 2 hours to take in the many features of the park. Owned and cared for by the Algoma Central, the park features not only magnificent scenery, but walking trails, picnic facilities, and a playground. A lookout 250 feet above the picnic grounds gives a breathtaking view of the canyon. One of the more popular rituals is to get pictures beside the locomotives, while back at the dining car, the also popular ritual of eating keeps the meal service staff going all day. Back at Hubert, Number 1 makes its daily appearance with a most interesting array of cars. As mentioned earlier, fall is the busiest season for the tour trains, and with seats in such great demand, ACR leases equipment from other Canadian roads to handle the overflow. The stretch consists of Number 1 contains not only ACR equipment, but that belonging to Ontario Northland and Via Rail. The tail end car on Number 1 is the Agua, one of the railway's 2 business cars. Both are available for private charters on the ACR. With one passed, the extra that had arrived earlier now leaves the siding and heads south to Steelton. At Canyon, Number 4's passengers start to board. Their train will depart once the approaching Number 1 clears the south switch. Continues its trek south, Number 2 now arrives at Canyon and lifts the overflow coaches left by northbound Number 1. During the peak fall colors, Number 2 gets a 30-minute run-late order from Hearst to Sault Ste. Marie. This is done in order to give the tour train overflow passengers a little more time to enjoy the Canyon Park. Things like this are a perfect example of ACR's interest in its tour train operation. Algoma Central's sharpest curve has a radius of 13.5 degrees and is located between mile 94.1 and 94.3. That's exactly where our camera is. With a permanent slow order of 25 miles an hour for passenger and 20 miles an hour for freight trains, watching Forrest swing around the curve certainly gives you an idea exactly how sharp it is. 2 miles south of here, the train crosses the Montreal River Bridge. With two having a run late order, four is well south of Montreal Falls by the time two leaves Canyon and heads up the hill to its first stop, freighter. As we cross the Montreal River Bridge for the last time, a look back finds 2's consist in direct competition with Mother Nature when it comes to variety of color. One of the reasons Algoma Country has such a splendid array of color during the fall is its large variety of trees. Maple, yellow birch, and white pine are common on the upland slopes and hilltops, while in the valleys and lower areas, spruce, balsam fir, white birch, poplar, and white cedar abound. Friendliness so common to the Algoma Central, Four's engineman gives a friendly salute with a horn as he guides the capacity train load of over 1,300 passengers the final few miles south to Sault Ste. Marie. Upon arrival at the Sault, each passenger will have completed the unique experience of riding a tourist train on a mainline railroad through an area of wilderness which rivals the beauty of the Canadian Rockies. As our look at the tracks of the Black Bear comes to a close, I'm sure you'll agree that with 24-car passenger trains, magnificent scenery, and unending hospitality, the Algoma Central Railway is indeed no run-of-the-mill pulpwood and iron ore hauler.